Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP NCORE, Enterprise Core, exam. In this video, we will review some of the Layer 2 forwarding concepts covered in the previous lecture video, as well as look at how to perform packet captures in CML. I have already loaded up the lab file. If you're not sure how to do that, check out the earlier Intro to CML video in the course. Now, unfortunately, the current version of CML doesn't have a text feature, so I am unable to add text to the topology diagram to indicate subnets, IP addresses, as well as write the lab instructions. I have heard they are planning to add text in a future version, but for now, all of the information is in the Lab Notes tab here. At the top, I list the IP info. There is only one subnet in this network, 192.168.1.0/24. R1 is the default gateway, and it has an IP address of 192.168.1.1/24. I have pre-configured this IP on R1 already. Switch 1's VLAN 1 interface has an IP address of 192.168.1.2, which can be used for remote management. Then, the three servers are .11, .12, and .13. I haven't configured the servers yet, so let's go straight to step 1, which says to configure server 1, server 2, and server 3 with the appropriate hostname, IP address, and default gateway. The commands to do this can be found in the Add Nodes tab. Hover over the server node, and it shows you. These server nodes are tiny core Linux nodes, very lightweight, and good when you just need end hosts in a lab to do simple things like ping. I'll demonstrate the commands now. I'll go on server 1 first, and access the CLI via the console tab. The default username and password for this node can be found in the CML documentation. It's username Cisco, and password Cisco. And now we're in. Let me check the current state here on server 1. Use the command route to view the routes it has. Only a route to the loopback address, 127.0.0.1, and notice in the interface, it's for the LO, the loopback interface. Now let's check the interface configuration. ifconfig. eth0 is the interface we'll be configuring. Currently, it has no IPv4 address, although it has generated a link local IPv6 address. Let's configure the IPv4 address and default gateway, which is R1. I have already prepared the commands, so I'll copy and paste them in. There we go. Now let me explain them. The first thing to note is that in front of each command, I have to use sudo. Sudo stands for superuser do, and it elevates your privileges to allow you to execute commands that require it. For example, I'll use the up arrow to return to the hostname command. Let's change this to server 11. But remove sudo. When I try to execute the command, I am told the operation is not permitted, and as you can see, the hostname is still server 1. The command didn't work. Next, the command to configure the IP address is ifconfig, followed by the interface name, the IP address, netmask, and then the subnet mask. In the third command, I added a default route to R1, making it the default gateway. The command is route add hyphen net 0.0.0.0 gw and then the IP address of the default gateway. So let's check if everything worked. I'll use route to check the routes. Up top, you can see the default route, and the gateway is 192.168.1.1, R1. Perfect. Then let's check eth0 with ifconfig. Now there is an INET address entry, and it is 192.168.1.11. I've also added one additional command, which isn't necessary, but it disables the DHCP service on the server. I noticed that even after configuring a static IP address on each server, they were still sending out DHCP discover messages, so I decided to stop DHCP on them. Okay, all's good on server 1. Now let's do the same on server 2. I'll access the CLI from the console tab, and again log in with Cisco and Cisco. Now I'll just paste in the configurations I have prepared, and that's it. I already explained these commands, So let's move on to server 3 now. Access the CLI, log in with username Cisco and password Cisco, and then once again, I'll copy the configs I've prepared and paste them in here. Okay, that's all for step 1 of the lab. I'll return to the lab notes now, and let's move on to step 2, which says to start a packet capture on the link between R1 and switch 1. This is a great feature of CML, which can really help your studies. It's not like the simulation feature of Packet Tracer, where you can actually see packets as they travel across the network, but it lets you capture all packets on a link and then view them in CML itself, or download and view the capture in external software like Wireshark. To do a packet capture, click on the link you want to capture packets on. In this case, it's the link between R1 and Switch 1. Then go to the Packet Capture tab. From here, you can simply click Start, which I will now. Now you can see messages as they go across the network. For example, Switch 1 is sending STP BPDUs. If I click on one of them, you can view the contents of the packet here. However, for a few reasons which I'll explain later, I recommend downloading packet captures and viewing them in Wireshark instead. Now, by default, in CML, a packet capture will only run for 50 packets. Once 50 packets have been captured, the capture will stop. I'm going to clear this capture I just run, and then go to Settings and increase it a bit. Let's say 500, then click Apply. I will manually stop the packet capture, so no need to have a low setting like 50. Okay, now I will click Start, and then let's go back to the lab notes to see what's next. Step 3 says to use R1 to generate unicast and broadcast traffic in the network. Okay, so I will go to R1, access the CLI from the console tab, and I'll use Enable to get to privileged exec mode. To generate unicast traffic, I'll just ping the servers. But how about broadcast? What traffic could I generate? Well, to send frames to the servers, R1 will need to use ARP to learn their MAC addresses. Let's check if R1 has entries for them in its ARP table. Show ARP. It doesn't. Perfect. So if I send pings from R1, it will have to send broadcast ARP request messages. So let's do that. Server 1 first. Ping 192.168.1.11. Because of ARP, you can expect the first ping to timeout, but after R1 learns the MAC address, the other pings succeed. Okay, let's ping server 2 now. Ping 192.168.1.12. And then let's ping server 3. Ping 192.168.1.13. Okay, we generated some unicast and broadcast traffic. Let's go back to the lab notes and look at step 4. It says to generate some unknown unicast traffic in the network. And how will this traffic look in the packet capture compared to the known unicast traffic? Well, known and unknown unicast frames are actually exactly the same. You won't be able to tell the difference by looking at the packet capture. The only difference is that known unicast means switch 1 already has an entry for the MAC address in its MAC address table, and unknown means it doesn't, and therefore it will flood the frame. So to generate some unknown unicast traffic, we can simply clear Switch 1's MAC address table, and then ping again from R1. I'll access the CLI of Switch 1, enable, and then first check the MAC address table. Show MAC address table. One thing to note is that, unlike my Catalyst switch I used for the previous lecture video, this IOSV L2 switch doesn't list all of those default static entries. Anyway, let's clear the table now. Clear MAC address table, dynamic. And then switch back to R1 and ping the servers again. I'll just use the up arrow to repeat the previous commands and ping server 1, server 2, and server 3. Okay, so we sent some unknown unicast traffic, meaning it's unicast traffic, but from switch 1's perspective, it's unknown. Now let's look back at the lab notes. Step 5 says to examine the packet capture and identify unicast, broadcast, and multicast messages. I included a note here saying in CML, messages in the packet capture only display when you are viewing the link's packet capture tab. So I recommend downloading the packet capture and viewing it in Wireshark. Let me show you what I mean. I'll click on the link between R1 and Switch 1, and let's check out how our packet capture is going. Look at the numbers here on the left column. These indicate the number of the captured packet. I can't view the packets that were captured while I was doing other things. However, CML did still capture those packets, so to view them, I will stop the packet capture and click on Download. Now it has downloaded the PCAP file, and I can open it in Wireshark. Actually, I have a PCAP here that I saved when I was running through the lab myself earlier, so I will use this for the example. By the way, I will include this PCAP with the course files, so you can check it out yourself, even if you are unable to do the lab. The first thing I want to point out is this first message, an ICMPv6 router solicitation message. There are a few of these in this PCAP, because the Linux servers have IPv6 link local addresses configured by default, so they are sending router solicitations to look for a router on the segment. Anyway, the first messages of interest are these two ARP messages. Message number 4 here is the ARP request R1 sent when I first pinged server 1. Note how Wireshark displays the source MAC address here. Realtek U 1477D0. Do you have any idea what Realtek U is? It's the OUI of the MAC address. When possible, Wireshark displays the vendor name for the OUI instead of the actual hex digits. Now, this is a Cisco router VM, and the actual OUI is 525400, if you look inside the frame here. You'll find this OUI used for virtual devices in CML, so don't be confused about why the vendor name in the OUI isn't Cisco. Then the ARP reply message is unicast, from server 1 to R1, informing R1 of server 1's MAC address. Then, you can see the series of ICMP echo requests and replies between R1 and Server 1. Then down here, the same between R1 and Server 2, and R1 and Server 3. When I scroll down to message 58, from here you can see another series of pings. This is from when I cleared Switch 1's MAC address table and pinged again. From looking at the packet capture, you can't tell that this was unknown unicast traffic from Switch 1's perspective. To repeat what I have said before, known and unknown unicast traffic are exactly the same. It's only known or unknown from the Switch's perspective. Anyway, the lab instructions said to look for multicast traffic too, and there are plenty of examples here. I'll do a filter for CDP traffic by typing CDP up here in the filter bar. There's one CDP message from R1, and the destination is displayed as CDP, VTP, DTP, PAGP, UDLD. Let's look inside the frame. And here is the real MAC address, 0100CCCCCCCC. This is a multicast MAC address used by all of those protocols listed. Now let me clear the filter, and at the bottom of this packet capture, there's a bit of a mystery. There's a gratuitous ARP from R1 at message 91, and then a series of ARP requests from R1, but the destinations are unicast MAC addresses, even though ARP requests are usually broadcast. Note that the cause of this wasn't shown in the video. I made this PCAP separately before the video. Let me know in the comments what you think the cause of this is. Okay, now let's return to the lab. In step 6 and 7, we'll try out a couple of the things we covered in the lecture video. First is to disable MAC address aging on Switch 1. So let's return to the CLI of Switch 1, and I'll go to global config mode with conft. Before configuring anything, let's check the default. Do show MAC address table aging time. 300 seconds, as you probably know by now. Do you remember the command to disable MAC address aging? You might think the command is no MAC address table aging time, but I'll try to enter that command, and now let's check what the aging time is again with do show MAC address table aging time, and it's still 300 seconds. no MAC address table aging time doesn't disable MAC address aging. That command just removes any previous MAC address table aging time commands that you might have configured. To disable MAC address aging, the command is MAC address table aging time 0. Now let's check again. Do show MAC address table aging time. Okay, now it's 0, meaning aging is disabled. Now, just to demonstrate how that no command works, let's remove the config. First, confirm it in the running config. Do show run include MAC. So, there's the command I entered earlier. No MAC address table aging time. And let's check again. Do show run include MAC. And now it's gone. And what's the aging time? Do show MAC address table aging time. Now it's back to the default of 300. Okay, let's return to the lab notes once more for step 7, which is to statically configure R1's MAC address on switch 1. Normally, you don't have to do this, but let's just practice the command. So to check R1's MAC address, we could go on the CLI of R1, but another way is to just check switch 1's MAC address table. So let's do that. Do show MAC address table. There it is, the one connected to G00. I'll highlight it and copy the address. Now let's configure it. MAC address table static, and let me paste in R1's MAC address. VLAN 1, interface G00. Okay, that's it. Let's check the table again. Do show MAC address table. Okay, as you can see, the entry for R1's MAC address is now static. Okay, in this lab, we configured some Linux hosts, tried out a packet capture in CML, and looked at a few of the concepts covered in the lecture video. Actually, some of the things covered in the lecture video, such as creating drop entries in the MAC address table and disabling MAC address learning, aren't supported in CML, but that's fine. You can still remember the commands. That's all for this video. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makara, Boson Software, Velva Jacum, George Streeter, Funny Dart, Nasir Chowdhury, Gustavo BR, Gerard Baker, Marcel Lord, Pavel M, Dragos Hirnea, Mayor Salmon, Mason Anderson, Vitaus 194, Gina Lindley, Nehemia, Bold 1C1U, Mark Jackson, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillem, Gabriel Braga, Renan Marias, Hector Hernandez, Ali Polat, Mara Tuba, R. Nelson, Roji Kuriakos, Roscoe Roy Gamer YT, Owad, Arpad Conives, 5 Feet, Daniel Brown, Emiliano Correa, Leonardo Souza, Tricky Mickey 123456, Scott Thompson, Jose Alvarez, Kevin Hayes, ES, William Rosario, and Hussein Yavuz. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So, if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching. Thank you.